call the September 10th, 2018 Board of Selectmen meeting to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, do I hear a motion to approve the minutes of the August 20th, 2018 regular meeting?
Second.
I need a motion first.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I move that we approve the meeting minutes of August 20th, 2018.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Abstain? Julianne, you would abstain, right?
Right.
Okay, it's past the hour of 7 p.m. Public hearing to consider an application to transfer the all-alcoholic beverages restaurant, common victualler, and entertainment licenses as submitted by RJ and JJ Holdings Incorporated, doing business as the Steak Loft Restaurant for premises located at 369 West Main Street. I know I saw Carolyn come in. If you guys can come up, whoever's going to speak.
Yep.
Please. And for the record, your name?
Good evening, members of the board. Mr. Goodair. My name is William Bloom. I'm an attorney in Westborough, not too far down the road, actually on the same road almost. And we're here tonight with Mr. Raymond Russo Jr., who is the principal of RJ and JJ Holdings, Inc., an entity created for the purpose of applying for the transfer of the all-alcoholic beverage license and for owning the assets of what's now the Steak Loft and will remain the Steak Loft restaurant. With us tonight are Carolyn Johnson, the current owner, and Mark Johnson, who's the executive chef. I think they're here in support of our petition. Sanjay Aruha, who has brought these parties together. He's the commercial real estate broker. So those are the people here for you tonight. The petition is very simple. Mr. Russo, 60 years old. Sorry, I'm dating you.
Threw you right under the bus.
Well, he just turned that, so you know, I didn't wish him happy birthday on his birthday. So he's 60 years old and spent his career as a software development director for two or three companies, and is from Massachusetts, originally from Waltham, his family living now in Acton, and is looking for a new career. And his dream, as crazy as I've told him I think he is, has always been to own and run a restaurant. And he's been looking for quite a while, and with Sanjay's assistance, was able to locate the Steak Loft restaurant as a possibility. And we've entered into a definitive asset purchase agreement. We have entered into a lease for those premises. And Mr. Russo is very anxious to get started. So we're here tonight asking for your blessing and your approval for the issuance of the license to JR and JJ Holdings, Inc., which is the entity. And Mr. Russo will be the manager. He plans to spend full time there. Mr. Russo has attended a four-day restaurant management business seminar and training. He is was scheduled to take the tips portion of it this coming Sunday. Received the text today that's pushed back a week to the 23rd. So certainly before the license would be ready to issue, he will have the tips training, and that will be submitted as part of his package, both here and on the state level. With that, if there are questions, any of us here in the room are happy to answer those.
Well, and we have a letter from the police department stating that they are okay with this transfer.
Yes, Madam Chair, we've got background on Mr. Russo with no concerns.
Okay. Questions from the board? Leslie?
Yeah, I just want to acknowledge Carolyn and Mark, and I, you know, this must be a little bit sad for you. I don't know, but that's what I gathered. You've put your heart and soul into this.
36 years.
Yes. And You have a wonderful reputation, and I just know you've worked very hard. It's not an easy business. And I just want to thank both of you for everything you've done and for having this business in Northborough.
You're welcome.
So thank you very, very much.
And if I could just say, they're not going anywhere anytime quickly because Mark is going to continue as the chef.
Mm-hmm.
And Carolyn has her hands full to train this gentleman here in terms of all of those nice comments that you just made and make sure that Ray is also going to be honored at some point down the road.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Years. Are you going to be keeping it as the steak loft?
Yes.
Okay.
Very good.
I grew up in Northborough, and again, to echo Leslie's comments, when I was a kid, I remember my parents going down every Friday and Saturday night. Where are you guys going? We're going down to the loft to have a couple drinks. So it's very it's very nice that it's staying as the steak loft, and it's nice to keep that sort of institution in town.
I should say that plan is, yes, to keep it the way it is, but to expand it. To expand the hours where there'll be lunch served again to a full 7-day week opening. And obviously once Ray is in the business and gets his feet comfortable, we'll spend money on improvements and so it'll last another 35 years, 36 years.
Now, do you plan to keep the prime rib? It's all my
best.
there's not better prime rib anywhere in the area.
Okay,
as somebody that has spent a lot of time in the steak loft and used to tap on top of Carolyn's steak loft, a lot of fond memories and a lot of nice dinners there. So thank you for everything you've done in the town. And you've got big shoes to fill. So, and this is a public hearing, so I'd like to open it up to the public. Any comments from the public or any questions? Hearing none, I'll close it to the public. And any other comments from the board? Hearing none, do I hear a motion?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I move the board vote to approve the application to transfer the all-alcoholic beverages restaurant, common victualler, and entertainment licenses from Freemar, Inc., doing business as the Steak Loft Restaurant, to RJ and JJ Holdings, Incorporated, doing business as the Steak Loft Restaurant, for premises located at 369 West Main Street.
Second. Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Good luck.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
Yep.
Okay, it's past the hour, 7:05 p.m. Skip and Pat Doyle, Rotary Club. Update on Applefest Street Fair and request to close Blake Street on Saturday, September 15th, 2018, from 7 a.m. till 5 p.m. So you'll come on up. It's always nice to see you back another year.
Another year. Can't count how many anymore.
It has been many years. It may not be 36, but it has been many years that we've been involved with the street fair. And I know that you've already read the reason that we're here, and we would like to ask that the Blake Street be closed on Saturday morning until late afternoon for the purpose of having the street fair. And we are proud and happy that the Rotary Club will be sponsoring this again this year. And John, I just want to let you know that I have been around to see all the abutters on the street to inform them that it is on Saturday. And Sue has been informed, and they were in the process of deciding whether they would stay open or not, which I doubt that they will. So.
We don't have quite as many vendors as we've had in other years, but we've got a full fair. We may have, there's always room. I must have had three requests today. Is there still room? There's always room because the way the street is configured, we can always get another booth in. So there is room if anyone hasn't as yet, gotten their booth. There's still time to get a booth. It's all laid out, but we can always squeeze some more in. It's looking very interesting this year. We've got a number of crafters. We have The, let's see, we'll have the Red Hot Tavern from Westborough is coming with their wings, and Muya will be there with hamburgers, and Trombettas will be there with ice cream, and then Mike's Vending, as always, and Kettle Corn will be there. So all the good things that we always remember from the street fair. Number of crafters, and what I think is kind of interesting this year, and as they started to come in, I actually made a list, is the number of fitness clubs in town, and taekwondo and martial arts. That's the majority, not the majority, but the largest number are going to be that, and I think it's just, some are even new to town. They're like first or second months or even just moving here. So it's kind of an interesting trend. So we're going to have lots of, you know, martial arts demonstrations and taekwondo and the rest of it. So it's going to be, it'll be a fun, fun street fair. The Rotary Club is going to be unveiling their program for the fall. It's called Nutrition 68, along with the school department, who's come on board with us. It's a school weekend backpack program for children that face 68 hours of hunger, from the time they have their free lunch on Friday until they have their free lunch on Monday. And so the Rotary Club is, we have some brochures for you. We're going to be sponsoring this program, starting with the Proctor School as our first school, and then hopefully expanding to all the schools in town, where we will be providing backpacks with nutritional food that the children can, we won't know who the children are. We'll just pack the backpacks and leave them with the school department, and they will hand them out, and then the kids will bring them back on Monday, and we'll pick them up and clean them up and fill them up again and send them out. So that's our program, and so we're going to be launching it at the street fair. So come and see what it's all about.
Thank you. From the police and fire departments, any questions or any problems?
No concerns.
Can I say no to the Rotary?
Okay. Board, any questions?
Not really a question, just a comment to thank you again for your continued volunteer work for this event each and every year. We really appreciate the work you put into it and your flexibility in accommodating the busy schedule of Apple Fest. So
it's going to be a busy one this year.
Yeah.
Thank you. So do I hear a motion?
I think skip it.
Sorry.
Sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to mention that when we were here the last time, when you were trying to make a decision as to when the parade would be this year, we would strongly urge that we bring the parade back to Saturday so that we have the street fair and the parade together. We think that one helps the other, and we just hope that you would consider that possibility for next year.
Thank you. I'm in total agreement.
Leslie?
Yeah, I wanted to say, when we talked about that, I actually made a note on my own calendar that the October, maybe one of the October agendas discussed that, because when they were here at this meeting, we said we needed to discuss this early in the game before anybody makes any arrangements with any of the vendors, so no one's surprised, no one can say, well, if you'd only told me, you know, that kind of thing. So I think we need to discuss it early in the game, and I agree. I'm hearing a lot of comments right now about that, that people really like it on the one day. It just adds to the whole vibrancy of the day and both events. So
thank you. Do I hear a motion?
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
I move the board vote to close Blake Street on Saturday, September 15th, 2018, between the hours of 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. for the annual Apple Fest Street Fair.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Motion carries. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you for everything.
Of course, we will see all of you there.
You will.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good luck with this.
Thank you, Patty.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Brings us past the hour of 7:10 p.m. Scott Trappendia, DPW Director. Informational presentation regarding completed water sewer rate study. Yes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Scott Charpentier, Public Works Director, and I'm going to give a brief summary of the 2018 water and sewer rate study. In the past, we've been working with Woodcock Associates for a number of years. Chris has chosen to ease himself into retirement. He's been doing this for a couple of years now, and Chris Woodcock had great foresight. He brought in Dave Fox from Raftellus to shadow him over the past couple of years. This is the year he pulled the ripcord for retirement, so we're working solely with Raftellus. Going to give you a little summary of where we are in the process. Dave will give you an update on the rate study and some details, and then after that, we'll take any questions you have. So there was an informational meeting with the Water Sewer Commissioners on August 14th. Our Selectmen liaison, Selectman Hirsch, was there. A very similar presentation. Gave the summary of the water and the sewer side, indicating what capital components are part of the rate study. We received a few comments from the commission. Most of it was narrative related. Provide a little more clarification here, maybe expand on the Marlborough status there. So the rate study you received in your package is, for all parts, the same as the rate study that was presented at that time. So a little history on our rates. As you're aware, the instability or questionable status of our Marlborough agreement has resulted in numerous significant rate increases to the sewer rates. There's been 5 20% sewer rate increases since 2011. We had originally projected a 10% this year to decrease again to a 5% the following year. Through the rate study, we've been able to adjust that to the benefit of the users. On the water side, we've only incurred one rate increase since 2012. That was 5% last year. So the rates, while they were steady and did not increase, our costs had increased over a number of years. So standard annual rate increases are expected on the water side. I want you to be aware the rate study is performed not in a vacuum. We have our capital plan and all the projected projects. Those are represented in the rate study through varying funding mechanisms. Those include equipment purchases and projects. And we also consider future use trends. And on the water side, the trend is less use. People are conserving water. So all that's been incorporated into the rate study, and I'll let Dave go through things. And if there's any questions afterwards, let me know.
You just did my job for me. I don't even know why I'm here. That was a great overview. Thanks. Again, my name is Dave Fox. I'm with Raftellus. We are the largest firm in the region and the country performing studies just like this, pricing financial management consulting services for water, sewer, and stormwater utilities. Like Scott mentioned, Chris Woodcock and I have been working very closely over probably the last 3 to 4 years. I talked to him on a daily basis. Been working with him here in Northborough for the past couple years, so this is not my first time working with you all. This process has been incredibly great working with Scott. It's refreshing to go into a study and receive information in a good format, and it's credible information. Thank you, Scott, for that. What we're proposing in our rate study is 5% rate increases on both the water and sewer rates. On the water side, we are not proposing to change the service fee, which is the fixed fee, although at some point in the future we may want to revisit that for revenue stability purposes, but we're not recommending an increase in that at this time. Key drivers of those 5%, and I'll get into a little more detail about the 5% in a little bit, but key drivers of those 5% increases: MWRA assessments, things that you hear every year, the cost of just, you know, providing water service to your customers, and things that are to some degree out of our hands in terms of cost control. So being a little conservative with our financial planning there. Like Scott alluded to, the uncertainty with regard to the Marlborough situation, being very conservative with our projections of how costs are going to increase or potential payback periods are going to affect our financial plan. Reinvesting in your system. You know, like Scott mentioned, you have a very detailed capital improvements plan over the next 5 years, laying out projects like renewal and reinvestment of your water infrastructure, your water pipes, pump station improvements, infiltration and inflow initiatives, things that will allow you to continue providing good, clean, safe service to your customers 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. You're performing the due diligence and doing what you need to do. So we have a plan not only for today, this upcoming year, but 5 years into the future as well, and start planning for those. Again, with the 5% rate increases, That's going to result in a typical residential customer here paying approximately $2.02 or $2.03 per quarter, which is a $9.18 increase per quarter, or a little over $3 a month, or 10 cents a day. That's what we're talking about here. To put that in a little bit of context for you, over the last 15 years or so, annually water and sewer rates have increased, water rates have increased by about 5.5% annually every single year for the past 5 years, and sewer rates have increased by about 6.1%. So the fact that you're below both of those numbers, and the fact that last year was the first year that you've had a rate increase since 2012, I believe, is pretty incredible. And you're reinvesting in your system, which is refreshing to see. I work with a lot of communities where they're not performing the capital infrastructure and capital reinvestment that is necessary, kicking the can down the road, and then all of a sudden needing a 50% rate increase rather than the 5% rate increase. So I applaud you for looking at where you are today and thinking about that going in the future. That being said, turn it over to any questions.
Okay, John?
If I may just make one comment before the board entertains any questions. I think it's important to just make sure that people understand the concept of water and sewer enterprise funds. Being an enterprise fund is a separate legal designation. Essentially, it's a separate set of books and accounting specific to the water department, and then a separate one for the sewer. And essentially, it runs those enterprises as a business. So the revenues that they generate from the fees have to cover all expenses. Operating, in other words, paying for the salaries, the benefits, the pensions, as well as to their point, the capital, the debt service. So if you need to rehab a water tower or replace water main lines, all those factors have to be worked into this business model and covered by these rates. The last point I would make is that by law, these enterprise funds do not generate a profit. Unlike a private water company where it don't exist to make money, the rates are set specifically to cover the cost of providing the service, no more and no less. And that's why it's important to have a very transparent process in terms of setting of our rates, what's taken into consideration, the assumptions that are behind those rates. And this is something, coming before the Board of Selectmen is something that we started, I don't know, maybe 10 years or so ago. When I took over, one of the things that I felt we weren't doing well enough in many aspects was making sure that we were investing in the capital aspects. You know, road improvements, in this case, pipes and infrastructure. If it's underground, it's easy to ignore. It's our job to make sure that you don't ignore that and we don't, as a community, ignore that. So one of the things that we started doing as we did these rate studies is we come before the board. Now, there's no action. The rate setting process rests with the Water and Sewer Commission, but the reason we bring it forward here is that transparency. We want people to understand how the rates get set, why they get set, and this is just a public relations informational presentation tonight. The approval process is laid out. Scott can speak to that. All users are notified by postcard. There's time for comments. There's a specific hearing held before the rates get set. So again, we view this as, I don't shy away from rate increases if we're covering the costs. And again, we're not making a profit, we're covering the costs. But the thing that I always like to highlight is that the costs aren't just the day-to-day operational costs. It's making sure that you're planning for that infrastructure investment. And that, I think, is really the shining part of what we've been able to do here. Is we have reasonable rate increases that are also taken into consideration those capital needs down the line. So I just want to give that context. Thank you for your indulgement.
Any questions from the board? Jason?
I'll ask a question. I'm just curious, just your viewpoint, given that we have the uncertainty with the lack of an intermunicipal agreement at this point, how often do you see something like that, or how does that affect, you know, how you factor that into the rate determinations?
Your situation is incredibly unique.
Great.
It's just unique. It affects our rate projections. not significantly, but we're just overly conservative in our rate projections because of that. Much more so than we would be if that situation were not the case.
Okay. We've structured these 20% rate increases so that as if a loan payback was implemented, and that loan payback payments for the large capital improvements they did at the treatment plant a number of years ago, that is in the retained earnings at the enterprise fund. So the enterprise fund is funding every single year as if we owe that loan payment. And we're artificially increasing our rates based on a conservative approach of what a possible IMA could look like. So we're anticipating a backlog of bill and a backlog of debt, and we've planned for that through our retained earnings. And that's one thing enterprise funds have that are somewhat unique. We do maintain retained earnings, fund balances. And we have the opportunity when we roll out a 5-year capital plan and a 5-year rate study to see that there's a million-dollar tank project 4 years out. Well, I want to plan for that. So we structure our rates so that when we get there, the loan process or the borrowing of the bond or the grant is more palatable because we have something in the savings account.
And just to follow up, I just want to thank Dave for the work done to produce the rate study. We've had Chris Woodcock for a number of years, and I was very respectful of his expertise. He's been very, very good. So it's nice to hear that we have this transition in place
I'll pass that along to
continue that. And also, Scott, thank you very much for all the work you do to maintain all these records, be able to provide this data in a very palatable form, and contribute to that. And John, for the capital planning that goes into this, because it's something that has been a very significant component of our financial planning and everything. And this is the kind of circumstance where that kind of planning, you kind of reap the benefits of it without a lot of surprises, a lot of high spikes in rates, for instance, that either through deferred or unanticipated capital requirements. So thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Leslie?
Yeah, also thank you very much. And that was pretty much my question. But to take it one step further, when we're talking about the Marlborough plant upgrade and what we could ultimately be assessed, is it that we have a pretty good idea about what we could be assessed, or are we anticipating a worst-case scenario? How do we plan for that?
The loan payback structure, it's an SRF loan. It's a state loan.
Okay.
It's public record. We have access to what their payback schedule is.
Okay.
We're aware of what the original intended ratio was before relationships went to where they are today. So we have a firm understanding of what it should be.
Okay.
If all reasonable minds are at the table.
Okay, that's great. Awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But if we just make one comment. I know we've talked about the situation with the intermunicipal agreement with Marlborough at great length. We are in court right now regarding the intermunicipal agreement. Essentially, the intermunicipal agreement, well, first let me back up. The town of Northborough doesn't treat any of its effluent. All of our sewage goes to the Marlborough Westerly Treatment Plant, and we were directed that we had to do that back in 1960 by the state because they didn't want to have multiple treatment plants on the Aspet River. So Marlborough was building theirs. The state refused to permit one for Northborough and said, you will become a tenant and a partner in that plant, where we have been ever since it was built. It's only in the expiration of the last intermunicipal agreement where there was disagreement. The agreement that we have, the intermunicipal agreement, determines how much we pay, our fair share of fees. So you remember when I said we don't make a profit? So the fees is a transparent process whereby you determine what you have to pay to cover the expenses. Well, we want to make sure that we have a transparent process, and the town of Northborough is very much in a position to pay its fair share, but there needs to be a transparent process for how those fees are determined. That's one of the things we're seeking. The other thing that we're seeking is, since the very beginning, going back to 1960, 1970, when we became a tenant and a partner in that facility, the town has had a 30% share of capacity of that facility. And that capacity share has meant we've paid 30% of the cost of running the facility and 30% of the cost of the capital investment in that facility. So at significant milestones over the last several decades, we have always paid our share of the capital. Sewer capacity relates directly to economic development, and so it's important that we maintain that capacity, and we've been unable to come to an agreement with the city of Marlborough about how much capacity we get in that new intermunicipal agreement. And the town isn't willing to take less than we have had since the inception of this partnership. So transparency of fees, the capacity we've had since the day we were required to be a tenant in that facility, those are the two things that we continue to ask for. And should be reasonably easy to get to through this process. It'd be nice if we can do it, at the table, but sometimes you need a third party to come in to help you sort these things out. The last point that I wanted to make, and I just want to give that context, the last point I wanted to make is when we talk about increasing our fees 20%, there's two types of water of sewer treatment facilities and fee structures. Ones that have been required to do a complete overhaul and upgrade and come into compliance with the new regulations and have a fee structure that reflect that, and sewer treatment plants that will have to do that soon. So the increase that we have planned for and the increase that everybody who runs a sewer treatment plant has seen is not unique to us. So rather, if you know that your rates may need to double, you don't wait till the year that it hits. You phase it in and you soften that increase. But when it comes to, and the gentleman to my left can speak to this more eloquently than I, but when it comes to sewer treatment plants, it is a very heavily regulated industry. And the treatment levels of the effluent that are going, in this case, into the flows of the Assabet River need to meet increasingly more stringent criteria and standards. And that's a good thing for the environment, but it comes at a cost. Well, what is the cost? In the last upgrade, and that last increase in the level of treatment resulted and will result in a doubling of the cost of the operation. So I just want people to understand why those rate increases have come. It's not that we've added any more staff or we're doing anything different. It has to do with the treatment to make sure that the effluent is at the highest standards to be released into what ultimately will make its way back into the aquifer. So it's all very straightforward. The only thing that we would like is if we get the intermunicipal agreement taken care of. We know we have this bill coming. Again, we want to, and we have clearly communicated that we expect to pay our share of the capital costs like we have going back to 1960. We just need those terms and conditions to be clear and to make sure that when it comes to what we're being asked to pay, just like when we ask our residents to pay a 5% increase, we want to be transparent and want to be clear about the methodology and why it's needed. Mm-hmm. So I hope that gives a little bit of context for folks who maybe haven't been around for the last 10 years while we've been discussing this issue.
Thanks.
All right, again, I appreciate your indulgence.
Okay, any other questions from the board? Thank you for the input, and thank you for letting us know what's happening.
Thank you.
Scott, before you step away, if I may, when's the public hearing?
The public hearing is scheduled for September 18th at 6 p.m. in Conference Room B.
So if anybody would like to have a question, would like to make a comment regarding the rate study or the fees, that's the place to do it. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, reports. Julianne.
So the first thing I'd like to say is that I am sorry I missed the August 20th meeting, but I do want to wish everyone a successful school year coming up. Second thing I have to talk about is the Northborough Historic District Commission. Their project to restore the headstones at the old burying ground behind the Unitarian Church is happening right now. You've probably seen people working there and the whole section is roped off. Many of the stones are already standing nice and straight and taller than previously. And if you want to see an article about the project, it's in the Community Advocate. Also, look for their table at Apple Fest to get some more information about the Historic Commission's work. The third thing I'd like to talk about is the Northborough Cultural Council. They'll be presenting art, music, food, and other activities on Sunday of Apple Fest. And they, I'd like to really thank them for all the work they've been doing to make sure that their first Culture Fest is a big success. They have even been meeting on Friday night in August to make sure that everything is going to be just so. So please stop by there on Sunday at the Unitarian Church. The fourth item is about the status of the White Cliffs Committee. We've received 14 responses as a result of the request for qualifications. Right now, the committee is reading through the stack of proposals and will be meeting soon to make some decisions. The first phase, of course, will be to protect the building from any further damage due to weather and other factors. So I'll continue to report on this as we move forward and make decisions. And in the meantime, my email is up on the Selectmen's page, so feel free to contact me. And the last thing I'd like to say is, in advance, thank you to the Apple Fest Committee for all of the hard work they're doing and bringing the town together. I hope everything goes in their favor, including the weather. And that's all I have.
Thank you. Tim?
I attended the school committee meeting last week. First of all, I'd like to thank Leslie for being so nice to introduce me to the board last week. That was very very nice of you. I appreciate that very much.
My pleasure.
Just want to welcome the students back to town, and just as importantly, I'd like to congratulate all the parents out there for surviving another summer with their kids at home, making it through. I'd also like to welcome the new principals that we have in town, the new principal at Lincoln Street, Jennifer Wright. My oldest son just started kindergarten at Lincoln Street, so both he and I are very much looking forward to working and learning with Principal Wright at Lincoln Street. And also welcoming Amy Soles, the new principal at Z, and the same. I'm sure that everybody's very excited to have her on board. Second, I attended the planning board meeting last week. There was two big points or topics on the planning board agenda. One was discussion of proposed 4 6,000 square foot duplexes going in on the corner of Lincoln Street, approximately 6,000 square feet duplexes on the corner of Lincoln Street and West Main Street, across the street from the post office. There was a lot of discussion about that. And there was some discussion about the timeline for the new fire station. So I just wanted to ask if there was a decision on, if a decision on a new fire station was imminent.
Well, as the chairman of that committee, I'll speak to the fact that we had a meeting this morning. We are hoping to resolve, we're going to try to site the building by the end of October. Our hope is to have everything buttoned up by the end of December, so that it can go forward at town meeting.
Okay.
So that's the plan right now. Hopefully having it done in December will give the public time to hear presentations and to show the need for it and justify the costs associated with it. But at this point in time, we're still between sites and haven't really made a decision.
Okay.
We're still weighing cost factors and safety factors and issues like that. But it is anticipated that it will be on this year's town meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for that information. I'm sure people will appreciate that. The other item was discussed was new home construction on Pleasant Street. There's a house over there, it's a historic house, one of the oldest houses in Northborough, and I know there's some efforts in town to have a buyer come in and protect that home from being demolished. Next planning board meeting is September 18th, and I know that the proposed duplexes is on the agenda for the September 18th meeting, so if people have any concerns about that, to attend that meeting. And lastly, just thanks to everybody in town for all the pre-work that goes into Apple Fest coming up. I know that the two-day event is puts a strain on people, so I just want thank you guys specifically, you know, DPW, the chiefs, the fire and police, and everybody in town and staff that puts the effort into making that happen. So thank you in advance. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay. Leslie?
Okay. The first thing I wanted to do was mention that Dawn and I met as the interview committee, some candidates for two different boards. One is the first one is the Conservation Commission. And I just did want to mention, too, to thank everyone who volunteers their time to, number one, apply, and two, come in and in their desire to serve the town of Northborough. So thank you very much for that. My first motion is I move the board vote to appoint Kelly Marston to the Conservation Commission for a partial three-year term to expire on April 30th, 2021.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor?
Second is I move the board vote to appoint Leslie Harrison as an alternate member to the Zoning Board of Appeals for a partial three-year term to expire on April 30th, 2021.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor?
Next, I'd like to, as usual, thank the fire chief and the police chief for their monthly reports. There's always a lot of really good information in those. In fact, one month, the fire chief or whoever does your Facebook page, you, I wondered if it was you, put some interesting statistics on there as a post one time, and I thought that was really interesting. And I think in the interest of transparency, I think that's a wonderful idea. I think the more information people have, the more they appreciate all the work that both of your departments do. A lot of people probably don't really understand the depth of everything that goes on in both those departments, so thank you very much for that. I was happy to see that the lot was mown at Pierce Oil building. Is it mown or mowed?
Mowed.
It's mowed?
It is mowed.
It is?
You mowed. Who mowed it?
I thought it was mown. M-O-W-N?
I think either.
Okay. In any case.
Mown is what you're going to hear if you take two of them.
That's true. Okay. But anyways, happy to see that was taken care of. I've asked Kathy at a couple of meetings about that. It always looks terrible. And I know that those landlords don't live in town, so probably really don't understand how awful it can look as people drive by it every day. So I'm hoping that there is somewhat of a regular plan for that. It does look a lot better right at the moment. Wanted to find out if there's any update on the light pole for the Northborough crossing. Do we know anything more about that? No. Okay, so the infrastructure for that is completed, so we're just waiting for the light pole delivery.
Foundations, loops, mm-hmm. conduits, conductors, wheelchair ramps, it's all there except the poles.
Okay.
So the poles are still waiting.
Yeah, okay. Apparently they were backordered, didn't they?
Yeah, there's a very, very long lead item for tall galvanized poles for some reason.
Are we talking months or weeks? Do you have any idea?
I don't. At the last Selectmen meeting, it was a long time, and it's a little less than that now. I wish I could give you more information. I don't have it.
The important thing is they need to be in and operational in advance of the Christmas holiday season. That's really the goal here.
Yes, that would be wonderful.
My understanding is they will be.
Okay, that'd be great. I may ask that every meeting just to get an update on that. So, okay, thank you very much. Also, usually every fall I mention the fact that the school district newsletter gets mailed out to every single resident, which I think is terrific. So even if people don't have kids in the school system, they still receive the information about what our schools are doing and who is running the schools and different goals and budget information, that sort of thing. But it appears that they're not being mailed, which I think is actually a fine idea because it saves paper and also just the expense of doing that. But there is a link if anyone is interested in viewing that. It's nsborough.k12.ma.us/backtoschool, one word. So those are usually very, very informative, but I can understand the justification in not wanting to do a complete mailing to all the residents in both Northborough and Southborough. One thing I wanted to actually talk to the police chief about is I'm hearing some complaints about the fact that at Kearney Park, a lot of people have their dogs off leash and that dogs are being bitten by other dogs, and residents don't really feel the peace of mind walking in there because they feel that there are a lot of dogs who are really running loose. So I wanted to know if there's any perspective from your standpoint, and if there's something more we can do.
Address with the animal control.
Yeah.
It's their primary purview.
Yeah.
I know that there's limited hours that they're in town, but it's not. If I have three people on a day shift to send somebody off into Kearney Park looking for dogs, that takes somebody off the.
Right.
Yeah, I can.
Yeah.
I can speak to this. So this is an animal control issue. Dawn has raised this in the past, and it's a lot like it's a lot like speeding. Mm-hmm. You know, you get complaints, you do a lot of enforcement, you get it under control, and then kind of it comes back for whatever reason. People seem to have gravitated to that particular location. Mm-hmm. So it's very easy for us. We'll get some basically directed patrols out there on a regular basis and issue some tickets. The last time we did it, a lot of the folks were from out of town and under the impression that somehow this was a sanctioned dog area. Unfortunately, this is, again, I think a casualty of social media sometimes, mm-hmm. where people are like, oh, it's a great place. This is where I go with my dog. Everybody's off leash. It's terrific. So it's difficult to battle that, but that's easy for us to address. We'll do some enforcement out there.
I would appreciate that.
Not a problem.
I haven't driven up into that parking lot recently, but I forget what the signage is up there.
There's ample signage. In fact,
there's
the
a leash law in
town. Dawn brought this up. We ordered signs and had them installed. You cannot claim ignorance. The signs are very clearly marked, and they're marked in the parking lot as soon as you get out and as you hit the trailhead. I'm not sure. I mean, I've hiked that trail many, many times. But as you get in and it opens up, there are signs in there as well. So we usually have the animal control. We'll just go in there and camp out for a while. So
okay,
if you're from out of town, you get a ticket. If you're a resident, you get a warning the first time.
First time.
I'm just kidding. Everybody gets tickets.
Okay. I appreciate that.
No,
thank you.
We'll do some more enforcement. Absolutely.
Okay.
Again, this is just, it's a beautiful location.
Right.
People gravitate towards it, but they have to be on leash.
Yes. Okay. I appreciate that. Thank you. My last item is that, as Tim mentioned, he and I both attended the K-8 school committee meeting last week, which was really interesting. They had a couple audience sharing portions, which I think was good. It gave some parents an opportunity to talk about a couple different things. I know buses were an issue, and I think that they've tried to rectify that. It's been difficult at the beginning of the school year for that. So there are some parents that got up and spoke about that. And one thing that was mentioned was the annual tour of school facilities. I guess hasn't happened in a while, but I did express the thought that I think it's important that they have one of those on a regular basis, so that anyone on any of the financial boards, our board, financial planning and appropriations, be able to attend. Because I think if we're responsible for the school budgets, that we all get a chance to see the inside of the school buildings. And a lot of time can go by before you're actually in one of the schools. So they said they would try and schedule that as soon as possible and include all the other boards for that. So that ends my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Jason?
Yes, just want to encourage people to get out over the weekend to enjoy the Apple Fest festivities. A lot of planning, a lot of hard work by the Apple Fest committee to put a program together. So make the most of it. It's our closing of the pleasant weather for the year so far, so it should be a very enjoyable time, and I hope people will have an opportunity to attend a lot of the activities and enjoy it. The Master Plan Steering Committee will have a booth at Apple Fest, which will have some kind of posters up and everything showing some of the details of some of the planning that's gone on to date and some of the topics and categories of goals and vision that they've reached thus far, and certainly looking for whatever input people would like to provide, or just to provide them with that information so they understand where we are in the process. And then finally, just wanted to note that September 4th marked the fourth anniversary of the loss of Brian Arsenault in Afghanistan. So we just recall his sacrifice and service and remembrance of his life here in Northborough and his duty to his country. So that ends my report.
Thank you.
Just one thing I wanted to mention, on September 17th, I believe at 7 p.m., Scott, the town common. So September 17th, 7 p.m. Here, there'll be a public hearing on the town common design. So as you know, we've engaged Wesson and Sampson as the landscape architects. They've worked on a couple of designs, and this is the first rollout of those designs and a chance for people to view them and comment on them. And hopefully shortly thereafter, we intend to bring the design to a final version and bring it forward for implementation. So project is moving along nicely.
I have a question. Is there any way that those designs can be at Applefest?
The designs are going to be presented at that public meeting on the 17th, on Monday the 17th.
Uh-huh.
The consultants are going to have them ready, and there's a narrative associated with design elements that I think warrants the presentation of them, as opposed to just putting them on a wall with static without a description.
I see.
Yeah. We were trying to get it for this weekend, so this was as quickly as we could get it. But to Scott's point, the idea is to walk through why the design looks the way it does and what the elements are.
Okay. So. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Public comments? Chief?
Just with the changing of the season, remember it gets cold before you know it, and people start firing up their wood stoves and their fireplaces. Please make sure you have a professional sweep. Check those out. Animals do like to build nests in those throughout the course of the spring and the summer. And you go fired up and it's plugged, that's a problem. And also make sure you have your heating systems checked, because we do a lot of heating system calls. So just keep that in mind. I hate to say it's getting cold, but it's going to, better to be on it now than later.
Thank you. Anyone else? Hearing none, new business. Final approval of the Green Community Program Plan. John?
Sure. At your last meeting, you had an excellent presentation by the Green Communities folks, particularly the associate planner from the Central Mass Planning Commission. Of the five criteria that we need in order to be able to be in a position to submit for a green community status, which is due on October 26th, in order for us to submit, we have two outstanding criteria that you saw a very good presentation on last meeting. One is the energy reduction plan. We were required to look at all of our energy consumption and develop a five-year plan that will reduce our energy consumption as an overall organization. And this is the municipal buildings, not the residents' homes, but our municipal operation, by 20% over the next 5 years. And so that plan has been put together, and we have projects, energy efficiency projects that we can do over the next 5 years to obtain that 20% reduction. The second thing that we need to do is adopt a fuel-efficient vehicle policy, which we discussed. Again, if we purchase vehicles, the goal is to make sure that they are fuel-efficient in accordance with the policy that's in your packet. So those are the two outstanding items. We anticipate us putting our submission in by the October 26th deadline, assuming the board takes the action that's being requested of them this evening. The benefit is, if we can get in by October 26th and our application is accepted, we believe we have a $145,000 grant that will be provided to us. That grant can then be used to implement that energy reduction plan, at least the first phase of it. Once we have a green community status and we have received our initial $145,000 grant, and we've done some of these projects, we then can become eligible for some competitive grants for additional energy conservation projects. So there's wins all around. There's no downside to this. I will say it's taken an incredible amount of work, particularly with the assistant town administrator, Kim Foster, and Kathy Jubert, working on this to get this application together for ultimately for submission. So tonight, we hope you look favorably and vote favorably upon these last two pieces.
Thank you, John. And we did have a lot of presentation last meeting, but does anybody have any questions?
I have a question. So the plan, the energy reduction plan, is this all of these documents from Guardian?
Yes.
And so the total cost on that over the, I guess, 7 years is about $2.5 million?
No, I don't, Kim, if you want to speak to, Kim was heavily involved in this. You want to speak to it, Kim?
The plan is the document. It says energy reduction plan. It lays out projects that can get us to a 20% reduction over time. We're not committed to doing every project listed in the Guardian document. That was an audit that was done that shows we have enough projects that could get us to a 30% reduction, but that's not a commitment to do those projects. It just shows there's enough that we can do to meet the requirement under Green Communities to achieve a 20% reduction.
Okay, I'm sorry, you probably did this at the last meeting and I wasn't here. So I was looking at this document and it looks like, for example, Town Hall needs a lot of work. There are a lot of upgrades that could be done at Town Hall, the fire station, for example. As we move forward with a master plan, will you be coordinating with them to kind of prioritize, or how does that work?
We're actually coordinating with the capital plan that has a lot of building projects laid out and timelines for instance, a new fire station is in the works, so we will not be looking to make any immediate investments in the current fire station. There's other areas that we're going to focus on, and a lot of it's driven by the capital plan that currently exists.
So really, think of it this way. We have to go through the exercise of identifying potential energy savings across our organization. That's what they've developed. Now it's really up to us through our internal process to prioritize these projects and decide which ones we're going to do. And to be perfectly honest, we're going to focus on projects that the state will give us grant funding to do. So the idea is that we're going to achieve a good portion of this energy cost savings through this grant program moving forward. And like any plan, we're not committed to this plan. This is an attempt to get all the information in one place and to identify potential projects. Then we'll need to use our intimate knowledge of the organization. For instance, as Kim just said, we're not going to do energy efficiency work over at the fire station if we know we're going to do a gut renovation or potentially move. So we take this plan and we mash it and mesh it with our capital plan and our master plan and all the other plans that we have. And it'll be a living document each year, just like the capital plan. We go back, has anything changed? Can we get grant funding for something? You know, if we need to replace boilers at a school, you know, then that's one way we can get energy cost savings there. The real key here is, we've got a menu to pick from, and we're going to match that up with our planning that we do locally, and we're going to match it up with grants that will become available at the state level. We anticipate, you know, the ability to get hundreds of thousands of dollars of grants moving forward because we've achieved this Green Communities status.
Well, thank you for that, and it looked like an enormous amount of work, so thank you.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, do I hear a motion?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I move the board vote to adopt the Town of Northborough Fuel Efficient Vehicle Policy in fulfillment of the Massachusetts Green Communities Grant Program Criterion 4.
Motion made.
Second.
Motion's been seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Thank you.
Madam Chair,
yes.
I move the board vote to adopt the Town of Northborough Energy Reduction Plan prepared by the Central Massachusetts Regional Planning Commission with support from Guardian Energy Management Solutions and the Town of Northborough in fulfillment of the Massachusetts Green Communities Grant Program Criterion 3 and authorize the Town Administrator to submit the plan as part of Northborough's Green Communities application for designation.
Second. Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Okay, motion carries. So thank you, Kim, for all
thank
your
you,
work.
Kim.
Okay, proclamation for the 140th Annual Homecoming Day for the Northborough High School Alumni Association. And we used to have Dick Sargent to come in and speak to this, and unfortunately we don't have Dick any longer with us. He was a driving force for this whole Northborough High School Alumni Association, and everybody else was too timid to come forward to speak to us, I guess. So, as somebody that's gone for year after year and gone to present our proclamation usually, I'm just going to bring it up. It's a yearly get-together for anybody that graduated from the Northborough schools, as far as Northborough High School or Algonquin Regional High, Aspen Valley. Also invited are kids from Northborough or Southborough, St. Peter's High School, and actually even St. John's if you were a Northborough student up to grade 8. So they do it. It's supposed to be the longest running homecoming in America. Alan Phelps, who served on many committees and as the town treasurer for years, used to say it was the longest running. And I always believed everything Mr. Phelps said, so so I'm going to swear by it. So it's going to be held this year on Saturday, October 13th at the Haven Country Club at 369 Cross Street in Boylston. And it's we always issue a proclamation. And the proclamation is full of be-as's and whereas's and is-as's, but it's basically the same every year. But I do plan on going, but if somebody else would like to go and present the proclamation instead of myself, that's fine. So, is anyone interested? All right, then I will present it one more time. And do I hear a motion on this?
Madam Chair, I move the board vote to proclaim October 13th, 2018 as Homecoming Day for the Northborough High School Alumni Association in recognition of its 146th reunion homecoming.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor. Okay. Homecoming Day, October 13th, 2018. Anybody that's interested, get a hold of Carolyn Squilanti. Okay. Next item, reappointment of Leslie Shore to the Cultural Council.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I move the board vote to reappoint Leslie Shore to the Cultural Council for a 3-year term to expire on September 30th, 2021.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor? Okay. Execution of Cemetery Deeds 1059 and 1060.
Madam Chair, I move the board vote to execute Cemetery Deeds 1059 and 1060 as presented.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor? Okay. We had an executive session scheduled, but we were hoping to hear back from the judge regarding the development, ANZA's development out on Whitney Street, and we haven't heard back, so we will not have an executive session. So, any other business to come before the board? No. So, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor? Okay.